be functioning in the Salem district, and who will monitor the performance of each branch in the Salem district towards the priority sector and agriculture. So they assigned a lead bank responsibility for one bank. Suppose for every district, they assigned a one bank as a lead bank for the particular district. That is the lead bank scheme. This is a lead bank, you may be confused. One is the even a consortium advance, when group of banks are financing for a particular industry, where the major bank is called the leader bank. That is different. This is a lead bank. This is leading the other banks in the public sector. So lead bank and leader bank are both are different. Leader bank is the bank which leads all other banks in a consortium of accounts financed to a corporate or big borrowers. Whereas the lead bank is the bank which coordinates the activities of all the banks in a particular district. That is the lead bank scheme. The main activity of the lead bank, see, bank alone cannot do the development of the economy of the district. See, lot of line departments are there. For example, Department of Agriculture is having certain schemes. Then Department of Horticulture is implementing certain schemes. Department of Agriculture Engineering is having certain schemes to the farmers. And then Directorate of Agriculture, they are implementing certain schemes. Who will coordinate? Otherwise, what will happen? Every department will go to a particular plant and sometimes they may not be able to reach their target, or some areas will not get the benefit from the bank, or the government schemes may not reach all the places of the district. So there should be some liaisoning between banks and government departments. That is the major responsibility of the lead bank. They should coordinate between various departments with banks. That is the major role of the lead bank. This is the prevalent since 1969. There are, I think, 751 lead districts, lead banks are there in this country. For coordinating this particular bank is assigned the lead bank responsibility. It is the coordinating efforts of the credit institutions with the government. Government and the banks, financial institutions, not only commercial banks, cooperative banks, then all other developmental banks like Taiko Bank and all these things, they will also be monitored by the lead bank. See, this after 2009, this scheme was again reviewed by Srimati Usha Kaurat, the then Deputy Governor. She made a study on the revamping of lead bank scheme, and they found that this lead bank scheme is very useful in the monitoring the credit flow in particular district, and it has to be supported, and they have recommended so many changes in the lead bank. They wanted that the lead bank scheme should be given topmost priority by the banks, and the experienced officers should be posted as the lead district manager, and they should be given with adequate infrastructure, and all these things were recommended by Srimati Usha Kaurat, the then Deputy Governor of RBI. See, there are lot of committees that are there in the lead bank scheme. See, we have to monitor at the micro level from village to district level. What is the village level? We have a block level bankers committee. See, there are three or four committees are there at block level, at micro level. We have to monitor the credit flow to a particular village or particular area. See, for example, Vomalur Talu or the Vomalur block, it may have about 56 villages. We must see whether the credit flow is equal to the all, equally spread in all 56 villages, and whether all the banks operating in that particular block are achieving towards the target what they have. That's the Small Industries Development Institute. Now it is renamed as the Medium Small Industries micro, small, medium enterprises development institute. The director of that institute will be also there in the meeting. Besides that, there are a lot of NGO representatives. Already I told some major NGO representatives will be there. Sometimes these small cities are functioning. Rural self-employment training institute is available in all the districts. And then officer in charge of that RCT will be also participating in the DCC. This is a normal DCC. Then what are all the DCC? DCC first point is that the real DCCs are gone. Suppose 35 blocks are there in a block, in a district, all 35 blocks will have a real DCC meeting. Every block, some blocks may have some problems with some department. So they will send the minutes of the meeting to LDM. So these problems faced at the village level or block level will be taken up with the district level for solution. Certain problems cannot be solved at the block level by the field level officials. That will be taken up with the higher level. Suppose one village do not have a veterinary sub-center, lot of cattle population is there, accessibility is not there, they want one mobile van for cattle animal husbandry department, then who will decide that veterinary assistant center cannot take any decision? So that problem will be taken up at the DCC level, where the joint director of the animal husbandry will be there, then POTR, DFA will be there. Some funds will be available in the infrastructure and the VRDA or some other collectors fund, relief fund will be there, collectors quota will be there in some funds. So from there they can allocate our MLA area development fund is there. So this type of problems when taken up at DCC, there is a possibility of getting a solution for such problems at the block level. And even some problems cannot be sorted out at the district level also. Suppose opening up a branch in the tribal area of a particular district, no branch is willing to open a branch, nobody is yielding because it is a loss-making proposition. Who has to decide that? Then the matter will be taken up to the state level bankers committee. See, BLCC at block level, DCC at the district level, and state level bankers committee. So DCC will discuss about the problem, whichever they cannot solve, they can take up in the SLBC. See, after this rural development, now financial inclusion has become the more important subject. So that has also been attached to lead bank. So every branch is supposed to prepare a financial inclusion plan. That is, what is a financial inclusion plan? All families should have a bank account there, and they should be given with OD facility and the digital banking like PAS, business correspondent, Aadhaar enabling, all these things are considered financial inclusion plan. So that review of the financial inclusion plan is part of the duty of the district consultative committee. So all the bank senior officials will be there. They will be discussing about the implementation of the financial inclusion plan. Then specific issues like IT enabled financial inclusion. What is IT enabled financial inclusion? We are having business correspondence. I think you will be aware of that business correspondence. In each village, bankers, 2,000 or 5,000, 2 or 3 villages, one business correspondent will be appointed by the bank, and they will be given with a point of sale lamp and device with all networking facility. They can make payment and also they can receive payment. Suppose the far off places, they cannot come to the branch and they cannot waste their entire pay for the try 100 rupees. So So the doorstep banking is the IT enabled banking is just digital banking. There are apps are there, the map and all these there, apps are available. Besides that, this PC, business correspondents are there, their performance also should be reviewed by the DCC. See, every district is having a financial literacy centers. What is financial literacy? See, lot of people may not know what is the role of the bank. Do we know, even after 37 years of service in bank, I don't know the complete services rendered by a bank. So if that is the case, what will be the case of a illiterate rural household? So they should be educated. Say many of them may apply of going to a bank, opening up SB account. See, lot of they will be going to chit funds, they will lose their money. And they will not save at all. Savings habit may not be there. All these things, how there are financial literacy centers have been opened in almost all the districts. And even the branches, these financial literacy centers will be opened. So they have to go to the villages. They have to educate the households regarding the need for savings. Then whatever the credit facilities available in the bank, then how to open an SB account, what are all the know your customer things, and what are all the things required for opening an account, how to get a debit card for getting money, all these things we have to educate. So this is a financial literacy center. That financial literacy center, lead the district manager has to review the progress of the financial literacy center to the BCC. Similarly, rural self-employment training institutes are there. These rural self-employment training institutes are funded by Ministry of Human Resources Development by our Government of India. Their main goal is to promote skill. Suppose if a bankers are providing a credit assistance to dairy farmers, say for example dairy farmers. See, some knowledge should be there, na? Because you are giving a 1+1 dairy loan to a particular villager. He is not at all aware of milk animal or milk killing or what is the type of feed, concentrate, green powder, etc. He may not be aware. So just giving a loan without the knowledge to a particular borrower will ultimately result in failure, resulting in the failure of the advance also. So what is the need of the borrower should be trained on the particular activity. So now this is for dairy. Sometimes some care is new items, sometimes cell phone preparing. You see, almost every household is having 3 or 4 cell phones. So how repairing of cell phones, that we should identify some barriers, we should give training through RCT, that is rural self-employment training institute. And they will give free training, free boarding, lodging, everything. And those trained persons, once if they are provided with the credit assistance, they will perform better than a raw borrower. That is the aim. So this RCT's performance should be also reviewed in the BCC. Then performance of banks at the district credit plan. I think we discussed about the importance of the lead bank scheme. What is the monitoring or coordination? Another is preparation of the credit plan at district level. Actually, branch plan should be prepared. Branch should prepare a credit plan each year, and the credit plan will be aggregated into a block plan, and all block plans will be aggregated into district credit plan. This district credit plan will be mainly concentrating on the priority sector advances like agriculture, MSME, social infrastructure, education, housing, like that. So priority sector advances will form the major part of the credit plan. This DCC will review performance of each bank under this priority sector and the credit plan. That is the major role of the district council review committee. Similarly, SNG, you know, SNG bank linkage is a legacy credit banking. Every village should be having at least 15 to 60 SNGs. Lot of NGOs are there, and one women development corporation is working, and each district is having a project implementation unit of the women development corporation. They coordinate the functioning of self-help groups in the villages, and these self-help groups, just formation is not sufficient. It has to be linked with bank credit. How many groups have been formed, and whether those groups are really eligible for bank loan, and if they are eligible, whether the banks are catering the credit needs of SHG, and if they are not doing, what is the problem? Whether it is a problem with NGO, or problem with the project office, or whether it is a problem with the animator secretary, so many things are there. These problems will be also discussed in the DCC meeting. Then lot of government sponsored schemes, various schemes are there, in the implemented by DIC, DACO, then the Backward Classes Development Corporation, Minority Development Corporation, Horticulture, National Horticulture Mission, in agriculture, lot of schemes for watershed development, pumps, tractors, all these things, lot of subsidy oriented government schemes are there. Whether these government owned schemes are, whether they are proper departments also present their performance block wise, bank wise to the DCC. So, the District Consultative Committee will not only review the performance of the bank, it will also review the performance of the life departments, and they have to tell why if they are not achieving, what is the snag, what is the problem, how to solve it. It is a mutual discussion between the banks and the departments, and some solution to be arrived at by the presence of the district chairman. So it will be, all the problems will be solved at the DCC level. Then educational loan, you know, lot of complaints that banks are not considering educational loan. One exclusive cell is there for the addressing the conditions of the educational loan of the students. So such problems wherever that is, that will be also discussed in DCC. Sometimes SME financing, there may be some problems in SME financing. So DIC representative will be there, he will be helping in solving those problems. Then in case of natural calamities like drought, flood or pestilence diseases, attack, etc., then what sort of relief measures should be there, then whether this district will be declared an anomaly or not necessary, what type of rehabilitation measures to be provided to the affected department. All these things will be the part of the DCC. So entire gamut of credit plus development departments will be discussed at the district level with the district chairman as the district collector as the chairman. So as normally the district collector is the final decision authority for any governmental program, and regional managers will be responsible for implementing it. Respective branches where you are lagging. So it will solve the problem and it will enable the district to achieve the targets. Relating to banking, presenting the those committees in selection of borrowers or training institutes or anything related to banking. He has to organize financial literacy. I have already told you financial literacy at village level. Financial literacy camp should be conducted by the FLC, Financial Literacy Center. Then similarly, all city is conducting training. So lead district manager should be in coordination. See where he should identify which activity of training should be given by training institute, or where we should do financial literacy, All these things that the LDF will discuss with the FNC and RCMP, and he will organize those plans at the village level. This financial literacy camp, only bank is not the only agency involved. Because now direct benefit transfer is there, and all the subsidies are routed through bank accounts. So all the government departments are also involved in bringing their clients under bank account, the banking scenario. So it is the responsibility of all persons to bring a financial literacy in a village. One more thing, he has to conduct quarterly public meeting in certain villages. There may be like some villages in the district will be more sensitive. There may be some problems with banks also. Branch managers may harass the customers, or customers may harass the branch managers in certain areas. And in many areas, they may not be aware of what government schemes are there, bank schemes are there. So, lead district managers should conduct quarterly visit to such villages for grievance redressal. I think you will be aware every Monday, all district headquarters in all district headquarters, collector will be conducting a grievances day. In the grievances day, lot of petitions will be received by the district collector. It will be registered there and it will be forwarded to concerned agency. For in respect of grievances expressed by public, with regard to banking, it will be sent to LDF for redressal. In turn, this LDF has to pass it to respective bank, get the reply, and he has to submit to district collector. I think they are issued an award also for speedy disposal of grievances redressal by districts. So, these type of grievances faced by public, LDF will have an idea, and he has to conduct a quarterly meeting. Sometimes his LDOs and the DDM, NABARD DDM and the lead district of RBI will also participate in that type of grievance redressal meeting connected with the villages. One more committee is the DCC meeting, I told you, district consultative committee. It is truly with the officials only, officials at the NGOs. But what about the participation of the people representatives? MLA will have some problem with his constituency, MP will have some problem, district panchayat chairman may have some problem. So how to address their views? And they will have certain views for development of the district. They are, I think you know, the MP land, MP local area development plan fund is allotted to each MP for development of their constituency. Similarly, MLA is allocated with the certain funds. So they will also try to implement certain programs in the villages. How to coordinate? One more committee is the district level review committee meeting. That is a district level review committee meeting. There, again, local MP, MLA, Zilla Paisan chiefs, they will be invited to the meeting. This is a once in a quarter. Quarterly meeting. DCC, one more meeting is DLRC, district level review committee. This district level review committee will have the representation of people representatives like MLAs, MPs, district panchayat chairman, of these people. Actually, what as an LDM, what we will do, we know if MLA and MPs come to the district level, they are from different political parties. One will be DMK, another will be ADMK. Again, it will look like an assembly. DMK MLA will do something and ADMK MLA will refute even like the DLRC meeting. So what LDM will use to do, the intimation of the intimation letters for DLRC, no, they will not send that in advance to MPs. MPs are MLA. If we send that, it's 50 15 days in advance. These MPs will diarize and they will attend the meeting and it will create a problem in the DLRC. So what majority of LDNs will do, they will not send the information to MP, or they will delay, they will say delay. When I was an LDN sailor, one MP immediately called me over, today evening you are having a meeting and you have sent the agenda paper only, invitation only in the morning. How I will attend? Either you postpone the meeting or you ask appellate. Likewise, he was asking. So what Sir Nag has told that these public representatives should be invited at least 15 days pending advance, and they should participate in this. LDS should see that they participate in the DLRC meeting. That is that one of the recommendations by our Usha Kaurat committee also, they have pointed out that adequate information should be given to public representatives so that they will be attending the meeting. Again, the lot of meetings are there. It is the duty of the LDM. All the meetings are conducted in a proper manner so that everyone should participate in the meeting. So suppose one BLBCC meeting is organized in 4 months and a single day, and if the department is having only one officer, how he will be able to go to attend the all the 4 block meetings? So he has to prepare a calendar of meetings well in advance. Before the start of the financial year, he has to prepare a calendar of meeting, and it should be circulated to Reserve Bank of India, NABARD, and then all the concerned MPs, MLAs, district collector, BLBC conveners. Everybody should be intimated when the BLBC should be conducted, when the DCC meeting should be conducted, when DLRC. So even I think a district collector, he will be having a lot of assignments, and he may give an appointment or he may give a date for conducting a DCC meeting on a particular day, he may not be able to attend. So like on the same day, Reserve Bank officer will have one meeting in Karaikudi, and he may not be able to attend the meeting at Salem. So everybody should plan according to this calendar prepared by LDM, and everyone should attend the meeting without fail. Then next one is the state level banks committee. See, BLBC over, then next one is DCC, then SLBC. The SLBC is the apex inter-institutional forum. As any problem with regard to policy making at state level will be discussed at the SLBC level. This SLBC will be chaired by chairman and managing director of the convener bank or executive. See, SLBC also allotted to some bank. Like DCC, we are a lead bank for one district is there. Na? Likewise, the SLBC convener, convening bank is also given to one bank as a responsible bank. For example, for Tamil Nadu state, the convener for the SLBC convener is the Indian Overseas Bank. Whereas for Union Territory of Puducherry, the lead bank for the Union Territory is Indian Bank. Similarly, for Andhra Pradesh state, the lead bank for the SLBC is the Andhra Bank. Similarly, every bank at state level also given the responsibility for monitoring the credit flow and for the coordination with the government and all these things. So, for SLBC, the convener bank's chairman or executive director will be the chairman of the SLBC. Again, just like DCC, another higher officials will be participating in the state level congress committee. See, the district level, joint director of agriculture will be participating in the agriculture department, whereas in the SLBC level, some director of agriculture or additional director of agriculture will be part representing the agriculture department. Similarly, the bank side, regional managers will be attending the SLBC, I mean DCC, And the SLPC zonal managers got some representative from their own head office may also participate. So many things, many decisions will be taken by SLPC, which will be put forth to RBI or NABARD. Naturally, they will agree to the SLPC. So all the senior level officials of the government department, all the, suppose the corporations are there, women development, for example, women development corporation at the district level, district project officer will be attending, whereas in SLPC, the managing director of the corporation will be attending. So whatever the problems unsolved by the DCC will be placed at the SLPC, so that the staff level officials will be aware of the problem and they will find out the solution. And not only is the finding out the solution, it is the responsibility of the lead bank to follow up with the government department or banks till the problem is solved. So they have to follow up with the problem, and if it is solved, it has to be placed in the next SLPC. The bill it is solved, it will be kept in the meeting. So everybody will be attending to the problems placed in the meeting. Here some other important departments like National Architecture Board, they are having a lot of schemes at the special invitees. Then they are not regular members, but whenever there is a problem regarding a farmers or industries, respective traders association or a farmers association, they will be also called for such meetings. It is on a quarterly basis. The DCC quarterly, BLDC quarterly, BLRC quarterly, SLPC quarterly meeting. See, SLPC will be convened for only 1 or 2 hours will be meeting will be there. They cannot, the chief secretary cannot sit for one day and discuss the problems. Before SLPC, they will conduct some group meetings, some committees they will form. Suppose that agriculture and financial inclusion, rural development, one subgroup will be there. One group for micro, small, medium enterprises. Another group will be for education or housing or other activities. Likewise, some subcommittees will be formed in advance. They will discuss the problems and they will give the solution. Suppose the Revenue Recovery Act. The Revenue Recovery Act is there, but it is not implemented. So recovery is not forthcoming. It may be one of the problems discussed in the Agriculture Rural Development Group. Who will decide about Revenue Recovery Act? Government only should ask the task force to implement the Revenue Recovery Act. So who has to give instruction? Then Secretary Revenue should give the instruction. So this problem will be discussed and placed into SLPC. And the SLPC, who has to take action also will be referred in the agenda. This problem implementation for just for issue of patta passport in district level. Action, Revenue Department. That Revenue Department should inform lead bank SLPC what type of action they have taken for implementation of that one. Like that, these subcommittees are also there in SLPC. In again SLPC, same type of DCC only. It is only a district level. Then we have training plan, financial inclusion plan, problems faced by various agencies at the district level, coordination between departments and banks, then education board, SLG, FSME. At state level, they will be discussing at the SLPC level. In SLPC convener, the major point is that the preparation of a district training plan. Medium NABARD will observe that what are all the views expressed by bankers
or
other agencies like that, and he will prepare a potential interim plan based on the potential available in the district, like agriculture, mine irrigation, watershed, women development, then KVIC, all these, whatever the potential available various activities, he will give a district level plan, and he will also give a block wise allotment. So he will study based on the block wise potential, and he will prepare a potential credit plan for district. Based on this, branches should prepare a plan at branch level, and that branch level plan should be consolidated at block BLDC. BLDC should approve the plan. Some banks, private sector banks, may not give loans to agriculture or their micro or education loan, all these things. But there may be some potential available in the block. Then the BLDC will decide whether that particular branch has prepared the plan correctly or not, and they may revise the plan also according to potential available. This block plan will be converted into district plan, then the district plan will be consolidated to form state level credit plan. Every district should launch their district credit plan on the 1st April of every year. So for that, they have to prepare a calendar of activity. When PNP should be deliver the, I will give it in the notes, you can verify that the activity schedule. What, when PLP will be prepared, when branch PLPC plan, when disciplinary plan should be launched, all these things, they have given a calendar of activity. So everything, finally on 1st April, plan, disciplinary plan should be launched in all the districts. Regarding SLPC, website is there. Each SLPC should have a website, separate website for them. That SLPC website will contain all the details about the village districts, financial inclusion plan, district credit plan, then branches operating in various blocks, districts, potential plan, then meetings of the SLPC, agenda, invitation, everything. It is there. It has been standardized, and the SLPC has been asked to have a separate website so that all can view the SLPC website and know that what is the credit plan, what are the various, somebody asked, you know, different schemes operating in the state, somebody asked. That will be also appearing in the website of the SLPC. Some light departments might have supplied information to the SLPC. So separate website is there for each SLPC, which will have a detailed information about the state. Another thing I have told about liaison with the state government. So naturally, like a LDM at the district level, SLPC convener should have a coordination with all the development departments present in the state level. And any problem is that they should take up. For example, for agricultural loan, the stamp fee and the registration fee are waived, for registration fee are waived for SFMR and SAT. I think only example I am telling. This may be valid for only 1 year. So in that case, we need not submit the special adhesive stamp and all these things on documents. That waiver is just given by a government order. They will specify this is permissible up to 31/3/2016. Suppose if we want to give loan on 1/4/2017, then we have to affix the stamp, etc. So it will be a problem. So if continuance of those things, every bank should take up with the concerned department, coordinate with them, and they should follow with them for issue of PO and supplying the same to all member banks in the state. So similarly, SLPC should coordinate with various departments. Then district credit plan, I have told simply branch plan, block plan, district plan, state level plan, based on the potential linked credit plan. Then monitoring of the credit plan. See, simply planning is not sufficient. It should be monitored through submission of some returns. There are earlier there were LPR 1, LPR 2, LPR U 2, like that. LPR 1 was planned, LPR 2 and U 2 are achievement in rural and semi-urban and urban areas. LPR 3 is recovery. Now they have modified into LPS 1, LPS 1, LPS MIS 1, LPS MIS 2 and LPS MIS 3. Three formats they have introduced. This is LPS, LPS MIS 1 is plan. District creditor, that is branch plan or district. Then LPS 2 is achievement of ACP vis-a-vis target. And LPS MIS 3 is the state-wise consolidation of the credit plan. Just you know the LPS MIS 1, 2, 3 are the returns to be submitted for monitoring the district credit plan at the district state level. Totally as of 30th June 2017, 25 public sector banks and 1 private sector bank have been assigned to lead bank responsibility in 706 districts, including union territory. Lead bankship 29 states and 7 union territories have been assigned to 15 public sector banks and 1 private sector bank. Actually, years, and this metropolitan is not covered under the lead bank scheme. So for Chennai, there was no agency to coordinate the problems of banks, or there's no plan for preparation of plan, credit, nothing was there for metros. So now they have included the metropolitan areas also as one of the districts, and again, the LDM is appointed. And the metropolitan areas also have been brought under the lead bank scheme. Then another thing, there are lot of trust for opening up the, see after this Prime Minister's Jan Dhan Yojana and financial inclusion, lot of directions have been given by the Department of Financial Services. One is roadmap for opening up banking outlet in unbanked villages. So unbanked villages with a population of below 2000 should be covered with either a bank or a business correspondent. So some banking facilities should be given to those villages below 2000. Similarly, below 5000 means some brick and mortar branches should be there. 5000 means real bank branch should be there. 2000 means some business correspondent or some other model should be implemented. To cover all the persons should have a doorstep banking. That is said, that also should be followed by SFBC. Then CD ratio. I think CD ratio is nothing but a credit deposit ratio. Normally credit deposit ratio should be 60%. In any state or district or any bank should have a CD ratio of 60%. Some districts will have less than 60%, some states will have less than 20%, like that. There will be regional imbalances between the states and will be functioning in that area. And so the special subcommittees will find out our strategies and they will recommend to the BCC for implementation. This direct benefit transfer, I think you may be knowing, now all the subsidies including LPG, subsidy, old age pension, this NRL, this village level that we have participated, rural employment, Mahatma Gandhi, Nareda, all these payments are done only through direct crediting to the bank account. See, the direct benefit transfer, that is called direct benefit transfer. Without involving the earlier, it will be deposited in one bank. and it will send to some other branch, then if they will credit or they will not credit, lot of problems were there. But now, they all the benefits are directly going through direct benefit system, directly it reaches the bank account of the beneficiary directly. So, this has to be also monitored by the state level banks committee and the bank. See, this direct benefit transfer is being reviewed by Department of Financial Services every week on Thursday, every week, and then executive director of each bank should attend that video conference with the Department of Financial Services. Similarly, state government also will be reviewed by DFS for this direct benefit transfer. They will be also having a video conferencing. Bankers and government departments will participate and their performance will be reviewed by Government of India. So, for this direct benefit transfer, what is the major thing we require? Everybody should have a bank account. Every beneficiary or every household should have a bank account. And this account should be linked to Aadhaar. So, Aadhaar linking should be also simultaneously looked into. So, already in Andhra Pradesh, they have reached nearly 90-95% all the bank accounts have been seeded to Aadhaar. Whereas in Tamil Nadu, it was only 50-60%. If it is not seeded to Aadhaar, there is a possibility of bogus transactions, etc. So, what government, this Aadhaar seeding should be also monitored regularly by the banks as well as by the SSBC. So, direct benefit transfer is also very important aspect. Seeding Aadhaar, then appointment of business correspondent in all villages. If this business correspondent name, mobile number, village should appear in the SLBC website. Even the Department of Financial Services Joint Secretary will directly contact the business correspondent and he will check how many such transactions have been taken place. All these things will be taken to be looked into by state level bank or BCC like that. These are all major regarding this one. Then other two areas, one is service area approach. Earlier the service area approach, there is a short term loan will be given by cooperative societies or RRBs. Medium term and long term loan will be given by commercial banks and PARBBs. So each bank was allotted with one village. There were lot of problems. The already one borrower will be with some other bank. Now that village is allotted to some other bank. He is not getting credit facility, like that lot of problems are there. So what, according to present recommendation, service area approach has been withdrawn. And any bank can lend to any borrower in any village. So that relaxation they have given recently. Even RRBs were given only, they have to only give the weaker section people only, they have to assist. Now they can assist for any type of borrowers. So that relaxation also given. Then okay, don't use the certificate. One of the biggest problem is for a borrower is to get the don't use the certificate. At least he has to pay some branch managers will ask them to get the don't use the certificate from 25 branches. See, getting a notice certificate from one branch itself is a very big problem. He will have to come by the morning, evening, tomorrow, officer is on leave, clerk on leave, manager on leave. It is for one branch. So for 20 branches, what will be the problem? When he will get the loan? So what they have suggested, notice certificate is completely dispensed to him. So you should not, bankers should not ask a notice certificate from anybody. That is also the relaxed. Suppose any borrower is having a 2-year finance, some other bank, how to find out? It will be the State Bank of India, he might have already borrowed that. He is now approaching Indian Bank. How to find out? He took the loan to use the debate. He will go all the 10 branches and will get the loan. What is alternate available? Now there are some registries are there. CERSA is one of the registries where the mortgage of land or house property can be registered with the database. So anybody, any branch can be a member of that CERSA and they can open the particular borrower's name. They will get all the details of the liability, land mortgage or building mortgage, where location, survey number, everything will be available in that CERSA register. So that type of measures bank should take up instead of asking the borrowers to go to all the banks. Then new concept is doubling of income by doubling of farmers income by 2022. This is very important. It is brought by BJP government. So probably this will be an important aspect for review, question and for everything, interview, all these places they will ask this question. How to double the farmers income by 2022? This is announced in the budget of 2016-17 and this is the various, this normally we know as an agriculture graduate how to double the only theoretically we can say good quality seed, where we are getting good quality seed. You know what is the quality of the seeds supplied by agriculture depot, and even companies have supplying only poor quality seeds sometimes. So supplying of good quality seeds, nutrient-based soil health, field investments, lab housing, cold storage. This is only already we are doing. Despite that, the farmer's income is not increasing. But anyhow, government has mentioned that e-platform across Thailand for marketing, strengthening of crop insurance, promotion of manufacturing by poultry beekeeping fisheries. This is nothing but what we are doing today. We are giving loans to loans and developing the animal husbandry and allied activities. That is the mixed farming, along with the crop husbandry, animal husbandry is also promoted. Soil testing we are doing, good quality seeds available in the market. Only being a cold storage warehousing may not be arrived. That only is given importance in the doubling of farmers of income by 2022. These are the major things in the brought under the lead bank scheme. Actually, see, after this, at least, if you remember BCC, DLRC, SLBC, it is official. Other things, I think, is it, are you able to understand or not? At least something, 10% are you able to understand? Then one more thing, I will take 15 minutes. I finished this answer. One more thing, lead bank scheme we have completed. They are, but Cargill Committee, lead bank, BCC, LDF, BCC, BLBC, DCC, BLRC, SLBC, increasing the farmer, doubling of the farmer's income, financial inclusion, these words, with these words, you can manage any question. The sector given by RBI. The next one is micro, small, medium enterprises. What we call is MSME, micro, small and medium enterprises is a priority sector. Then export credit, then education, then housing. Now there have included a new area, social infrastructure, lending for social infrastructure. This was not available in the previous guideline. Now they have included social infrastructure. Then renewable energy, financing for renewable energy, is there another area of priority sector and some other areas? See, now one by one we will go fast. It's very simple and you can also refer to the circulars. Wherever what is important, I will tell you. This agriculture, you can have farm credit. One is farm credit. Then second one is agriculture infrastructure. One is farm credit. That is whatever direct loans that we will discuss later. Second one is agriculture infrastructure. Then third one is ancillary activities. Under the agriculture, the farm credit, agriculture infrastructure and ancillary activities. These three are the subgroups under farm agriculture. This farm credit is divided into two groups. One is what I call the non-corporate or individual farmers, and another one is corporate farmers. See, non-individual means whatever individual, including SHG. Individual means not only individual, it includes self-help groups, joint liability groups. That is, SHG is having a homogeneous group of women farming in a group, should be 220, all these things are there. JSD, nothing, 4 or 5 farmers joined together and they will get a loan for them and they will divide among themselves. Or they will be, as the JSD itself, they may get the loan. So joint liability groups, then group of individual farmers, if you have disaggregated data. Suppose individual farmer loans, they can get. Suppose if banks are having data on self-help group and joint liability group separately, they can be also taken as the farm credit. That is, loans given for agricultural and allied activities to SHGs, JSDs, that should be also taken under individual category. Whatever the purpose, agriculture and allied activities, dairy, fishery, animal husbandry, poultry, beekeeping, sericulture, etc. So all the agriculture directly engaged in agriculture and allied activities. The loans given to individuals who are directly engaged in agriculture and animal husbandry activities. This may be crop loan or a working capital loan for dairy farm or sheep, the poultry units may require working capital. These are also included under the farm credit. Then medium and long term loan to agriculture and allied activities. Long term, medium and long term for agriculture and allied. For long term, what is long term? Picking a new well, deepening, land development, draining wall, all these things are required long term or long term crops like this. So long term, medium term goals. Then pre and post harvest activities. For harvest, combined harvest, financing for combined harvest, storage goods, then transport materials. See, they will give only pre and post harvest activities. It is up to the bank to justify whether it will be matching within the agriculture or not. So they have given just pre and post harvest activities up to 50 lakhs. Sorry, post harvest activities. Then, hypothecation and pledge of produce. Produce marketing loan you may be knowing. So, farmers may pledge the produce they produced in a storage plot, where the warehouse receipt will be taken to the bank, and against warehouse receipt, the bank will be financing. Like that, here also, up to 50 lakhs it is eligible, that it has to be repaid in 12 months. Within 12 months, if they want to keep it in warehouse or storage, that also up to 50 lakhs becomes an individual. Then loans to business farmers intended to non-institutional lenders. See, in the recent criminal incident, you know, indebtedness where some suicides taken place in the district collector. See, farmers affected in the, I think the Maharashtra, some suicides have taken place, farmer suicides have taken place by Puri due to drought and that. So like that, any farmer, distressed farmer, having a liability with a non-institutional lender, that is money lenders, that is also eligible under agriculture. Then KCC loan, loans to small and marginal farmers for purchase of land. See, that is also provided, purchase of land by small and marginal farmers for doing for agriculture purpose, not for constructing houses or for any other commercial purpose, it should be for agricultural purpose. This is coming under farm credit loan to individual farmers. Corporate farmers, same thing, but the beneficiary will be farmer producer organizations. Now let us trend farmers produce organizations are formed there with the group of farmers. Then companies of individual farmers are there, where it can be also assisted when partnership of cooperatives, all these things. Activities, whatever activities I have told earlier, like NCC, long medium, long term loan, crop loan, everything. For individual, for corporate, if you give, it is loans to corporate. It is only up to the 2 crore mark. That is only difference between corporate and non-corporate. For corporate, I have fixed the limit of rupees 2 crore. For individual, I have not fixed the any limit. Even 5 crore, if we give for any farmer, it will be coming under loan to individual farmers. Then second one is, this is a farm to farm credit loan, farm credit. We have spoken to corporate and non-corporate. What is agricultural infrastructure? Loans for storage without warehouse, market yard, cold storage, soil conservation, watershed, tissue culture, agri-biotechnology, seed production, biopesticide, biofertilizer, vermicomposting. These are all only illustrated. This is an agriculture infrastructure. What is required for a farmer? These are all produced by tissue culture, they will supply seedlings, saplings, etc. The biofertilizer, production of biofertilizer, all these forms under agriculture infrastructure. This is sanctioned limit under crore in a banking system. Suppose 100 crores one bank cannot finance. So, 2 or 3 banks may finance for a particular company. For this, suppose for example, cold storage unit, very big cold storage unit is started with a 100 crores loan. 2 or 3 banks may join together. So, we have to take up the aggregate sanction limit by the all the 3 banks. It should not exceed 100 crores. Which is within 100 crores, it comes under agriculture. Then ancillary activities. Five crores to cooperatives, farmers cooperatives. Up to 5 crores for farmers cooperatives for selling of farmers produce. Suppose there are in certain areas, Panganapuram and all these things, cotton market will be there. Cotton regular is cooperative marketing societies will be procuring and cotton from farmers. They have paid the proceeds to the farmer for which we can lend. There are up to 5 crores if we are lending to that farmer cooperatives. It is coming under ancillary activities, agriculture. Then setting up of agri clinic and agri business center. That you know, agriculture grant rates and the agriculture veterinary setting up of buildings or any trading agri business centers, the sale of fertilizer, hiring of tractors, implements, etc. Those things also coming under ancillary activities. Food and agro processing up to 100 crore per borrower. Food and agro processing, rice mill. For example, rice mill, earlier it was under micro small medium enterprise. Now it has been brought under the umbrella of agriculture up to 100 crores in the entire banking system. So anything rice mill or similar type of activities will be coming under the ancillary activities. Then financing for directly we can finance to primary agricultural cooperative societies. We have one farmer service society sponsored by bank. That farmer service society requires some refinancing purpose. For that, the bank can lend to FSS. And then LAMP, large size area multi-purpose society. In tribal areas, you may be having a LAMP society. The LAMP societies can be financed by banks. And we can also finance for microfinance institutions for on lending to all these activities. Either we can directly, bank can directly finance, or we can finance through microfinance institutions to these sectors. That is, they have to give for agriculture. Micro FFI should give for to their members for agriculture ancillary infrastructure, then it is coming ancillary services of the agriculture. This is the agri. What is a small farmer and what is a marginal farmer as per RBI? There are so many definitions of a small farmer, marginal farmer, but as per RBI, small farmer means up to 1 hectare. Sorry, marginal farmer is up to 1 hectare, then small farmer is up to 2 hectare. See, there is a, they have not mentioned that whether it is irrigated or garden or dry land. They just mentioned that acreage, hectare, that is 1 hectare is marginal farmer, 2 hectare is a small farmer. This landless, suppose the leased the lands are there, tenants are there, sharecroppers are there, landless agricultural laborers are there, all of them will be classified under SF or MF according to the land they are cultivating. Suppose tenant farmer cultivating about 2 hectares will be classified as a small farmer. The tenant farmer cultivating 1 hectare will be classified as a marginal farmer. Then agricultural laborer without any land, he will be also classified under marginal farmer. Then loans to SHG, JHG, engaged in agriculture, farmer production companies, engaged in agriculture, allied animal, all these things. Suppose if you are giving to SHG or JHG or any farmer production companies, we want to classify them under small farmer or marginal farmer category, at least 75% of their number and 50% of their total land holding should be by SFMF. At least 75% of the members, if they are small and marginal farmers, they can be brought under SFMF. Because this is important, because we have a target for weaker section, where small farmer and marginal farmers are included under weaker section target. So, if we include all these things, we can easily reach the target. Then next one is micro, small and medium enterprise. Here, two types are there, micro, small and medium enterprises. One is manufacturing sector. One is producing some activities, some machines, some produce they are manufacturing, that is manufacturing sector. Another one is a service sector. So MSME is divided into two sectors. One is manufacturing sector and another one is service sector. So again, here we have to classify under micro, small, medium. This has to be classified in both manufacturing as well as service sector. In manufacturing, we classify as micro, or small medium based on the investment in plant and machinery. Manufacturing sector is classified as micro, small and medium based on the investment made in plant and machinery. Whereas in service sector, investment in equipment is considered as a basic for classification. So, in case of manufacturing sector, micro means plant and machinery up to 25 lakhs. Plant and machinery may be 25 lakhs, but you may give loan up to 2 crores or 3 crores. Again, it is called a micro. Classification only value of the plant and machinery, not the quantum of loan. So, micro is up to 25 lakhs, small is 25 to 5 crore, medium is 5 to 10 crore, based on the plant and machinery. Second one is service sector. Then service sector equipments, it is based on the investment in equipment. Service sector, what is the example, anybody can tell? This manufacturing, they manufacture some thing, but in the service sector, some call centers or petrol pumps, trading, services, all these things, they provide service to the people. So, this is based on the investment in equipment. Investment in equipments. What is the equipment they are purchasing? What is the cost? Based on the micro means up to 10 lakhs, then small means 10 to 2 crores, and medium is 2 to 5 crores. Then all loans to Kalyan Village Industries. Kalyan Village Industries is having a set of activities, about 50 to 70 activities. KBI is classified as KBI activities. Those loans given to KBI will be under MSME. Then other finance to MSME include supplying of input artisans and village and cottage industries. The institutions which are supplying inputs to artisans and village and cottage industries, and also for marketing, they are also eligible under MSME. Then general credit card like artisan card, weaver card, lakhu udyami card, sarvodayi card, so many hundred cards are there. All these cards given to enterprises are all coming under MSME. Then we have opened PMJDI, all millions of accounts we opened under PMJDY. That is, no frill accounts we have opened. Na? Each account is eligible for 5,000 rupees for productive purpose, overdraft facility. They need not open with any amount. Instead, they get 5,000 rupees loan as OD. That is also from effect, with effect from April 8, 2015, whatever the OD facility given to that PMJDY account, that is also coming under MSME. Because this is one of the areas for micro enterprise. We have a target for the great target for micro enterprises, for which this also we can take it. This PMJDY overdraft will be also eligible for target under micro enterprises. Then outstanding under Sindhi, Mudra, under 3RP sector, all these things will be eligible under priority sector. Then suppose we are classified micro, small and then medium based on the limit earlier. The unit has crossed to that level. That is the original plant and machinery, investment plant and machinery, micro 25, medium 10 crores. It has crossed 15 crores. Then whether it will lose its priority sector status? No. As per the guideline, they will continue to be MSME for next 3 years, even if they have crossed the medium enterprise level. So that loans given to the MSME sector also will be covered under the MSME. I think balance, I think tomorrow I will cover. So in the meantime, you will get this handout supplied by them. You can have a look into it. We will discuss further tomorrow. Huh? We already better with a lot of information. Thank you.